Praise the Lord. I was praying as to what I should speak on. And this is what the Lord gave me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me, and if you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Now, it became so difficult. I was telling my brother Michael, I said, today I'm going to be exposed because I'm going to speak, and there are a lot of things that the Lord wants me to speak so that many of you can take home something that happens when you're not connected to the Lord. If you're not connected to the Lord, and if you're not a branch, you will fall apart. And this I've seen in my own life. So I'm taking this for the first time after coming to the Gulf. I'm sharing this, and I hope it drives home a lesson to each and every one that we have to remain in the Lord and work in the ways of the Lord. My childhood and youth. And there he says, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and future. Do you know that when each of us is born, they have a blueprint for each and every one of us? The blueprint shows in what direction we will be growing and where we will walk in the ways of the Lord. This is the blueprint that God brings out. Are you aware that in Dubai, the municipality has a blueprint for the next 25 years? It is like every year what they have to do and how Dubai is going to develop. Why are these blueprints made? Blueprints are made to achieve, and that is laid out in front of you. So also, the blueprint was laid for me. I was born, and when I was born, everybody called me Gandhi. The reason they called me Gandhi is because I didn't have any hair. A newborn baby, and they said, look at him, no hair at all. And went on. Today I've come back to the same thing. It's come back the whole circle, okay? So, Blondie over there with me, giving me company. Then after that, I grew up in a very poor family. And all along, remember one thing, wherever you grow, your Father in heaven takes care of each and everything of yours. You are carved, I am carved, the palm of his hand. He will never desert you, never forsake you, because he loves you, he loves me. We are all precious in his eyes, and we will always remain precious to him forever. Amen? We moved on in life. I came, was a very naughty boy. See, I'm trying to expose a lot of things that I wouldn't like to speak otherwise. And I was put into a boarding. I was put into St. Paul's, Belgaum. And there, we had something that was very nice, and that was a daily mass. We were asked to go for a daily mass at 6:30 in the morning. We freshen up, get into our school uniforms, and the next thing is the mass. Every day we went for a mass, though during those days, the mass was just a formality. Because if we did not go for mass, we wouldn't get our breakfast. So everybody would be in line, we'd go for mass, come back, and we grew up. As we grew up, we started going to, we became this altar boys. Some of us were selected to be altar boys. And during those days, I was in the fifth or sixth standard. As I became an altar boy, they were asking us to come to the convent to serve mass. That was the most interesting part, because you'd get to see girls out there. Okay? And as you go, we are juniors then, so all the seniors used to give us love letters to give it to the girls inside the convent there. Life moved on. I mean, it was just a thrilling ride there. Went on. And we reached, something was attracting me there was the mass. The mass was so beautiful. We were going, of course, the catechism was there. Everything else was there. But the morning, the first thing that we go for a mass and come back was very, very attractive. Okay, fine. Went on. Still, it did not make any meaning, did not make any sense to me, and we moved on in life. Now, when we were in the youth, one fine day, Bishop Valerian D'Souza, the Bishop of Pune, he came down to Kolhapur, where I come from, and they held a 3-4 day retreat. Good enough. But before that, a year before that, I had gone to a place called Miraj, where one very, very anointed man of God, Father Joe Santiago, had come to give a retreat. So they said, come. Should we all go? And youth, of course, boys and girls together, let's go and have fun. So in our drive, we went there. And what I saw was the power of God. This man was so anointed. I just went and I sat in the corner here to watch what he is doing. And you could see people possessed, coming in like a kite, just flying over and falling at his feet. And he was pulling out all the evil spirits that they were possessed with. One lady, very specifically, I don't even forget her today, she came right in front and she was spinning. Her head was going round and round and round when she just, Father Santiago said, come here. She said, no man, no, I won't go. This is what she was saying. No man, no, I won't go. No man, no, I won't go. He said, come forward, come forward. Opened up her eyes like this. He just held her and opened up her eyes. How many more are there with you inside? And she said, there are 10 more evil spirits with me inside. He said, what is your name? And she gave her name. I was stunned. I was watching this for the first time in my life. And she gave her name. The next moment he did this, he just laid his hands and he said, in the name of Jesus, I command you to leave her. And she went flying, literally flying, and she fell on the floor. And you know, this is like you see terrible action going around you. You are like, you don't know what is happening. And I was just so scared. The next thing I thought, I'd go flying. Well, I'm sitting right next there and he would try something on me. But it went on. And later on, as they went on, there were a lot of prostitutes in that area. So those prostitutes who were coming, he was driving out evil spirits left, right, center. Now, here this one slowly got up. And she came forward. He got hold of her, opened her eyes again, looked into her. Okay. He anointed her with oil. She walked. Her husband was there with her, of course, and they both walked out. As they walked, I followed. I wanted to know, I get into the thing of it, what exactly is there? I walked out. She was sitting under a tree. Her husband was next to her. So I went up to her and I said, since when did you feel that you're possessed? She looked at me. She looked at her husband. Again, I said, I hope you don't mind, but I'm just wanting to learn what exactly happened to you. She looked at me, looked at her husband. Then her husband said to me, she doesn't know a word of English. That was a shocker. I said, she doesn't know, but she was just now saying, no, man, no, I won't go. It was all the evil spirit speaking. And he said, my wife is a Gujarati, and she knows only Gujarati. She doesn't know anything. Wow, man, that was something that I took home. And I still remember, I didn't want to meet the priest. I slowly walked up from the other side and told all the youth, let's go back. In the evening after the session, got into the car and all of us getting in. I had an ambassador in India during those days. Just put it into reverse, suddenly I saw somebody peeping right into my window. And lo and behold, it was Father Joe Santiago. And I said, oh my God. I said, Father, I hope you not come after me. And he said, I came to know you people have come from Kolhapur, so I just come and I'm just introducing myself because you didn't even say hello to me. I said, saying hello to you is dangerous, Father. How can I say hello to you? Then he took us in. We went for a cup of coffee. But this was action. This is what Jesus did during those days, and here you could see it now. Went on. Life moved on. Then came this retreat where Father Bishop Valerian D'Souza came. Youth, during that age, fun. So these guys came and they said, you have to join the retreat. So all of us youth went for one night and we said, okay, we're going to have good fun, okay? Let's go to the retreat and have, don't look at these holy Joes, let's go and have good fun. And let's make fun of them. 2 days, believe it or not, we were making fun of these guys who organized it. Look at that holy Joe go. Look at this joker go, etc., 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 went on. The third day was the praying over. So I told our youth people, I said, let's go. Let's let them pray. You hold back, I'll hold back. We are not going to give in to whatever they are doing, but let's have fun. Now, I walked in, everybody went in. We are in a big hall, then we are taken to different rooms. And I still remember the person who prayed over me, his name was Vinu, a brother who was heavily into drugs. And the Lord touched him and he came out. And he had come with his team with Bishop Valerian. Now, as we went in, we were in a room and outside the window. Now, I was just beginning in life. I wanted to be a businessman. I was looking out and there I saw a beautiful, beautiful building. Deep within my heart, I said, I should build a bungalow like this. And then he said, brother, I'm going to pray over you. I said, go right ahead. Then he said, please close your eyes. I said, no, that I won't do. Pray. As he prayed, I kept looking at the building. Wow, that has a blue color. Oh, this white combination would be good. That building would be good. And this, we have the two-story thing. We'll have this, that. This is what was going on in my mind. But that man laid his hand and kept praying. As he continued praying, my eyes automatically closed. And as my eyes closed, I suddenly felt I was no more sitting on a chair. I was sitting on clouds. And he continued praying. I started sweating profusely. This happened at the age of 26. Profusely I was sweating, and suddenly I felt I can sit on that no more, and I got onto my knees and just knelt on my feet and I gave my life to the Lord. This was one of the most beautiful times in my life. Well, the best part is I started growing in the Lord, and of course during those days I was in love with a pretty lady who did not belong to the Christian community. She belonged to royalty. She was the father was the first in command to the Maharaja of Kolhapur. And it was very difficult for a Christian getting married to a Hindu, out of the question. All right? My father-in-law tried to talk to me and tell me, this doesn't happen here. We are royalty. You are a nobody. So please forget her. I said, I will forget her if she forgets me. That's all I said. And it went on. The meeting went on for an hour and I left. And then during those days, since I had come to the Lord, it was a year before that that I had come to the Lord, I kept praying, I kept fasting. I kept praying, I kept fasting. I said, I want to get married to this girl only. And now it's become more of a challenge than just going across and get married. So it was going on. And believe you, my friends, few people came across and they said, we are getting you married. And I said, how are you getting me married? He said, we have to run away. And my marriage was a runaway marriage. Okay? I mean, you must be looking at a terrorist, no? What a guy. This is... In the night at 2 o'clock, my friends went with guns and everything, loaded with guns. I had spoken to my wife, to be wife then. I told her, come out of the house without anything. Just come. I have the funds. I have the money. We'll do everything. We'll buy a whole this thing for you. But just come out. Walk out. The car will be there. They told me, you don't come because they recognize you. So you go straight to Belgaum and wait there. I went to Belgaum, waited there. This car went in the night. The first night, they went. Sorry, the first night they went, the first night I went, the whole thing flopped. They came back empty. And I was waiting in Belgaum. So we had a party. The night before, we had a party, bachelor's party and all. Next day morning, I come back home. I'm a bachelor still. And my mother is at the door, and she looks at me, and she says, "You come back?" Because she was the only person, you know, that I was running away and getting married. I just came back. And then I said, the guy who was the fellow in between who could go into the house and get her out, he had not come. So next day afternoon, I went on to our regular place where we have our chai. Those days, I used to smoke. I said, we used to have our cigarettes. I was sitting and I was wondering what went wrong, when this joker arrives. I said, where were you yesterday? A car had come, people had come. He said, Marathi madhe. He said, you know, Sahib, kal amosha hota. Arre, you know what amosha is, no? Huh? Oh, I said, oh my God. Arre, amosha hai, maza lagna sa amosha dhala vandla. So then he said, don't worry, today night, sure. So next day night, I forgot to tell you this also. Two priests I had taken up to Belgaum. They also came back empty. So it was like, you know, a big mix-up. Came back, finished. Next night, we went, trip successful, went there, went to the registrar's office to get married. The priest had already gone back, so they were not there with me. We finished that and we went to the registrar. They said 1 month's notice. Now I said, if I give notice, then we have to come back to sign after a month. By that time, my father-in-law will be waiting with guns to finish me off. So nothing of that sort. We left. And we left to Goa, got married in Chandor, in a wonderful, wonderful villa. Not a villa, sorry, a building, a huge one with 45 balconies. Huge. Chandor, once upon a time, was the capital of Goa. There it was there. And then the person there, uncle who was not married, only to maintain that building, which has come down from his ancestors, he said, don't worry, we are hiding you here. You stay here as long as you wish and you can go. That is the moment I fell in love with Goans. I mean, they didn't even know me. They didn't even know. We should clap for the Goans, shouldn't we? They didn't even know me. I'm just there. And this is another fellow coming in with his runaway bride. And he opens the door to us. And we stayed there for a month. They became my family. As on date, they are the closest to me. I am the godfather to one of the children there. And the bond was solid. Went on, finished, got married. Back home, everything subsided. Everybody was cool. Father-in-law was cool. Mother-in-law was cool. All the full royalty was cool. Okay? By the time I came back, it was 3 months. And I still remember, I was in Velankani before I came back after 3 months. And by that time, my wife was carrying the first baby. And I prayed to the Lord. I said, Lord, I'm here. I want to know what it is. I always wanted a daughter first. I said, Lord, I want to know what it is. And I got a very clear, clear voice. This is going to be a son. I told my wife, I'll lose anything in the world. It is going to be a son. And my firstborn was a son. We came back to Kolhapur. I started. Now, this is where the drama begins. I came back, and then I wanted to be a very successful businessman. I had tremendous ambitions and tremendous things to do. My father was into tire business, and I wanted to take that tire business into a very, very big level. There is the disconnect. If you're not connected to the vine, what happens to the branches? I somehow kept God in the back seat. I said, now I'll take over. And I started taking over. Came back to Kolhapur. I was so successful, so successful. My one shop, first thing I told my father, you give me a shop, I'm going away. Because he said, why? You can do it from my place. I said, no. my ways are different and your ways are different. If you're going to sell a tire for 50 rupees profit, I'll be selling it for 10 rupees profit. And I want to see that I have more customers and the turnover is more. And it triggered off, it clicked. Clicked big time, I became one of the biggest dealers of MRF tires in Kolhapur. And this I came to know was what I was selling at a very low margin when somebody filed a case in Bombay against the government saying that the taxes that you have collected against the agriculture tires is wrong. It has to be only 2%, you're collecting 10%. So suddenly the MRF man came to me. He said, Vijay, some good news for you. I said, what happened? You're going to get a refund from the government. And I said, refund from the government? What for? No, it's about somebody filed a case in Bombay and the agriculture belt, they have to pay back whatever taxes collected. They can keep 2%, 8% will be a refund. In the meantime, I was doing one thing very faithfully was every week, 2,500 rupees from my business would go as a tithe to the church. And it used to go without fail. My accountant would come on a Saturday night and say, this is the money, sir, for the church. So keep it aside. Next day it would go. 2,500 every week. So much so, my father started saying, you're mad to give money like this to the church. I said, no, Dad, you just stay out of it. Watch what happens. And this case was won. And guess what? The amount I got as a refund from the government was 25 lakhs. Praise the Lord. That's how faithful our God is. 25 lakhs came back and I didn't know, neither did the market know. Suddenly the market woke up saying, this is the biggest dealer here in Kolhapur. And I said, praise God, it's been good. Growth, put up a big industry. I had about 50 people working for me, 5 tire shops. It was going on big time. As it was going on big time, during my youth, I had written a lot of dramas. See the disconnect. I'm not asking God for any direction. I am writing my own blueprint here. I went, I said, I've written a lot of dramas. Now I'm doing well in tire business. Let me make a movie. Let me do what I'm passionate about. And I went to make a film. And I made a film. It came out. And the first 2 weeks of its release, it made big time money, but not as much as it could recover the cost of the film. Because next, it was 1993, there was a bomb blast. And in the bomb blast, many theaters and everything went empty. And wherever our pictures were released, it failed miserably. This is the time I started falling. I started going back. And as I started going back, everything started flopping. My business started flopping. The film was already a flop. And I didn't know what to do. And one day it came to so bad that the family, I was holding on with my family. I was always doing everything for my family. That same family turned around and said, it's because of you we are in this mess. It's because of you we are finished. You brought us into this mess. You do something. It got so bad. I sat with my family. I said, okay, there is a loan of 25 lakhs. I said, y'all do one thing. Y'all get out of it. I'll take the loan on my head. I'll fight my battle alone. My father immediately said, what do you mean? You mean that we'll be on the streets? I said, okay. Then y'all take the business and I will go out and y'all take over the whole thing. Next thing is, he said, is that means to say you want us to take the loan? So both ways I was caught, you know. I didn't know what to do. And it became so frustrating, so frustrating. At last, I said, I was sitting at home. People wouldn't let me come to my place which I built. I didn't know what to do. In the meantime, before this, during our good times, we were into big time where contacts were concerned. I had the DIG, I had the DSP, I had the collector of Kolhapur as my personal friends. Wherever, whatever I wanted, I could just do it on the phone call. I just called them and said, this is a problem, that is a problem. They would solve it for me. It was so good. People in Kolhapur knew. I mean, this guy is a big time. You want to know the best part about it? We had such good contacts. One day I come home to travel to another place, which was about 2 hours away for a wedding. And I came home and my wife was crying. And I said, what happened? She says, we lost our dog. We had a nice white Lhasa Apso dog. And I said, what? How did he go? She went out of the door and it's gone. Now I said, don't cry. Now it's gone, let me go. I went for the wedding. By the time I came back, I saw a police car with an inspector and four constables. I thought something had gone wrong and I just rushed into the house. Go to see, he was sitting there. I said, how are you, what's happened? No, he says, DIG Sahibani Patola, DIG Sahib has sent me to your house. I said, to my house, what happened? No, they told me that you've lost a dog. Oh my God, I didn't know where to look at. And I said, who called the DIG? And my wife said, I called. He was a very nice person. His name was Uday Singh Rajwade, classmate of Rajiv Gandhi, a very nice, fine gentleman. And that guy said, you know, I didn't know where to look. I looked at him, I said, Kaika. Then he said, wait, I'll find the dog for you. I said, you'll find the dog for us? Yes, sir. Just give me 10, 15 minutes. He went out of the house, neighbors here, there, and all. He asked, questioned people. The jeep was gone. Believe you me, in 20 minutes, they were back at my house with the dog. So I just looked at him. I said, how come? You know what he told me? I am the police. And police, even if a purse is flicked, we know where the purse is gone. But it's up to us whether to bring it back or to leave it as it is. So they found the dog and they found out that one Sardar's son had come. These people used to come and collect all the scrap out there. They knew where they were staying. They went there and then they asked one guy when they entered the colony, did you find a dog? He said, yes. Okay, fine. Where? It's there. When they went there, they got hold of the guy and gave him two raps. He said, you flick the dog. Sorry. And all, they gave the dog back to him. They brought it back. Now, when there are murders, rapes, everything happening around the dog, around the place, you have a police coming here hunting for a dog. How do you find that? I just said, thank you very much. You'll go from here. And there, that was the type of time I had. You know, we were in right on top. Now I came down to the ground. I'm nowhere. And I said, what went wrong? Whatever I tried started sinking. It was like quicksand and started sinking so badly, I didn't know what to do. I just got on, picked a bag, and I went straight to Pota. I went to Pota, and I started crying to my Lord. I said, Lord, what has happened to everything? I've lost everything. Everything is gone. I've got loans up there, and I've come to ask you for mercy and forgiveness. This is where I connected back to the Lord, where I said, here I am, Lord, I've come. And I will do everything according to your will. You tell me what I have to do. Now, deep within my heart, I didn't want to leave Kolhapur because our name and fame was there. At least we could bounce back. But the retreat began. And the second day, they had the praying over. Father Matthew was praying over. And he started taking names. As they were taking names, one after the other, he said, the Lord is blessing Varghese. And deep within my heart, I said, Lord, my name is not Varghese. So I don't take that as my calling. Then next immediately he said, the Lord is blessing Vijay. Oh my God. I said, yes, we are on the right track. Fourth day, I went to Father Augustine Valurun and he opened up. I said, this is the problem. I lost everything. I'm in such a bad shape. What do you think I should do? There is a call from Dubai. Should I go or not go? He just opened the Bible and he said, goodness and mercy shall follow you all the days of your life. I said, wow, praise God. At least, you know, there was this word in the Bible. I kept, okay, went off. Last day came, and I said, still, I didn't get an indicator from the Lord that I have to go abroad, go to pick up the Dubai thing, okay? So I was very happy, and then I'd made two friends who were from Goa, Portuguese-speaking people, so they became very good friends and all. Said, They said, Vijay, you're going to Cochin, right? I said, yes, I want to go there, meet an uncle. I want to forgive him, because that is what they said, forgive anybody whom you could hold anything against. So he said, come in, our ambassador. We are going to the Cochin airport. From there, you have to go ahead. No problem. We got into the ambassador. We started going out. As we started going out, now, to the left is Cochin, to the right is Thrissur. These people are going straight across. I said, that is the road to Cochin. He said, brother, come. We went straight, and then we came to a house where it has got about 35 to 40 blind people who are praying. I don't know if you all know about this, but they took us there. I didn't know about it. We went there. So he said, let's go there. Let's finish the prayer. Let's go back. Okay. Now, these people are so powerful, they would be praying and praying and praying. Four batches are already waiting there. We would be the fifth batch. So one by one, they finished. As they came, our turn came, we all got inside. And then they started praying. Now, there would be a one blind man standing here, one person next to him who can see. And the prayers would begin. So everybody's praying. Suddenly, he would tell the other person, there is a person with a liver problem. He is healed. And can you raise your hand? So the person raises his hand. Somebody with kidney problem, raise your hand. As we prayed one by one, healing started taking place inside. Wow, man, this was fantastic. Then he said, again we prayed. He said, there are three people in this room the Lord is blessing who are to go abroad. Oh, I said, praise the Lord. Here is one place. Let's see what happens, I said. And he said, please raise your hands. Now, there was one person, if you know, a very good preacher called Fritz Mascarenhas. He was there. And there was another person. And that's it. Two hands went up. I was a stubborn fellow. I didn't put it up. I wanted to stay back. I really didn't want to come to this part of the world. Again, he asked the person who can see, he says, how many people have raised their hands? He said, two people. He was a little confused because whatever he says comes to pass. Yeah? They're very much in the Lord and anointed people. Again, he said, let's pray. Went on praying. Again, he said, there are three people in this room the Lord is anointed who have to go abroad. And again, I kept quiet. I kept my hands down. Two hands went up. Now, this time, you could see the irritation on his face. You could see that, you know, this is, something is wrong here. Went on, let's pray again, he said. Went on praying. Again, he said, I can see that the Lord is blessing three people who are supposed to be going abroad, and he's blessing them. I still remained down. I said, another hand will come up. Two hands came up. Then he said, there is one stubborn brother here who is not raising his hand. I put my hand on top at last. I said, okay, here I am. And I came home. I still remember my condition, my brothers and sisters. Listen to this. Why I say, if you're not connected to the vine, which is Jesus, your condition, you know, the devil always tells you, you know, the way I was going up, people used to come and say, wow, Vijay, what a fantastic thing. What you're doing is excellent. Whatever you touch is gold. Whatever you're doing is right. And people used to look at me to say, Are, look at this guy. See the way, from where to where he's gone. And some people started comparing me to my father. Said, he's got one shop here. This guy's made five shops the other side. He's put up an industry. And that ego, that pride, you know, like I felt like, oh my God, it was because of me I'm reaching somewhere. Because of me I've reached here. I've done this. Everything, and pride is one of the biggest evils. Forget anything. Do not have the pride. We got out of this, and I know when I came there and he told me this, I came back, I didn't have money to come to Dubai. A person who would walk into car showrooms and I would choose a car without paying for the car would be registered in my name. And it would come to my doorstep, and I used to write a check for 3 lakhs and 4 lakhs and give it to him. Those were the days I've seen. And here I was. I didn't have 10,000 rupees to buy a ticket to come to Dubai. And yet, you know, I said, this time I said, come what may. Some people, the industrialist called me and said, Vijay, we'll give you money. We'll back you up. We know what you're capable of. you can bounce back. But this time I took a call. I am going to go according to the ways of the Lord. I will walk according to his ways and I'll come this side. I got connected to the vine. I became that branch. And I trusted the Lord fully. I just said, Lord, take me. Whatever you want me to do, I'll do this time. Came back. I came to Dubai for the first time. No job for 2 months. And guess what? I've always been an owner. Here I'm hunting for a job. I got into one job. And those guys saw that this guy is seriously working. Well, I used to be working like, you know, the owner of any company. And there they said, they started, all the politics started. Beautiful things which I'm experienced for the first time. All this happened. I was thrown out of jobs. I went to another job. Slowly went on to an industry that is a laundry. That too flopped. Again came back. And then we started one more business which flopped and went on. And this time somebody cheated me big time. And I said, Lord, what is this? There's a Gujarati guy who took goods from me for 200,000. And he cheated me big time. And he was very rude. He said, I give a damn what you do. Whichever court you go, whatever you do, I've got the best lawyer. And I'll see that you will come out on the roads. I came back and I started crying out to the Lord. And, you know, everything went completely berserk. One evening, I finished my mass. And I went home. And I just shut myself into the room and I was praying to the Lord, Lord, take me. I've had enough of this. I don't need this. I don't want money. I don't want anything. And I just want to be there in your presence. Take me to, I want to die this night. This is my prayer to him. Everything was dark. I don't know when I went to sleep. Next day I got up. I got up in the morning and there was, again, I'm telling you, the loan was for 1 million here, 1 million dirhams. And that is why I was getting frustrated. The next morning, my son comes home, my elder son. He says, listen, you, your company will merge into another company. They will take over all your loans and you are a free man. You will have capital for your company. And that morning, that whole burden that was on my head was taken away. Praise the Lord. I came for Mass in the evening, and guess what? The Mass was, that day was the feast of St. Michael, our archangel. And my Lord spoke to me very clearly, you have the most powerful angel I'm giving to protect you. Nothing will go wrong with you. That itself was such a... Just imagine, you're loafing with a load like this of 1 million and just moved away and I'm just there. I said, wow, praise God. And ever since, I mean, right from, for 22 years, we went into hospital, prison, labor camp, all these things. But I was, you know, that greed is there for money. You want to make more money, you want to make more businesses, you want to do a lot of things. But the Lord has now proved to me it is not the wealth of this world that you are after. You have to be after the wealth in the next world. Showed it to me very clearly. Praise the Lord. And I just accepted. I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? And he said, keep going. Keep going. All your things will be taken care of. He reminded me one thing. Your passion was to make a film. Today, your son, your eldest son, is the head of film division in Media City. Praise God. See, beautiful things happened. And then he started showing miracles after miracles. When I came in 95, my son, my youngest son, he didn't have legs. I needed money to, see, because the principal called me and he says, there's an inferiority complex going on here in your child. We don't want the child to attend the school anymore. And I came back home and I was, you know, praying to the Lord, Lord, I have to take him for an operation. He has to be, his legs have to be amputated. A new set of, prosthetic, this thing has to be given to him so that he can walk. My dear brothers and sisters, my bank balance was 60,000 Indian rupees, nothing else. I went back and I just called a friend of mine from Kolhapur. I said, I need my son to be operated. The expenses are 7 lakhs of rupees. He just said, you're doing it. Don't worry about the money. The operation is there. Once the operation is complete, tell me, I'll transfer the money into your account. Listen to this. My focus is on my friend. My God is saying, I'm there for you. Okay? That is left aside. I'm human. We are human. You know, you understand that. You just walk across. We took him to the military NDA at Pune. The legs were amputated. Operation was a success. Everything was there. The day came to be discharged, and I was waiting for the bill to come. So the fellow brought the bill, and I looked at the bill, and he said, there's something wrong with the bill. So he said, no, 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 it's correct. I said, there's something wrong with the bill. I know the bill has to be 7 lakhs. Just take a guess how much the bill must have come to. Can anybody take a guess? Take a guess. Sorry? 60,000, 50,000. Anybody else? 700? 30,000. The bill was for 500 Indian rupees. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a big round of applause. And later on, I talked to the person in charge, the head of the department, the army guy. He said, we know your story. We know the background. So I called up the chief in Delhi and I told them, we should wipe away this bill. And then he said, I could have wiped away even the 500 rupees bill, but that was the catering bill, not our bill. So I could do nothing with it. And that is how the Lord started proving one after the other, I am there for you always till the end of time. Be connected to me. I am the vine, okay, you are the branches. My dear brothers and sisters, I want to just drive home one point. Please be there connected to the Lord and you'll see beautiful things happening. Amen. Thank you very much.